If you look at diplomacy, the importance of diplomacy for any nation is very, very high. You know, just like as an individual in a nation, you look for peace, stability, prosperity, and justice. Every nation also looks for peace, stability, prosperity, and justice at the global level. And it is the diplomats, and it is the responsibility of the foreign ministry people and diplomats that their interest of the national interest is really projected very well at the global level. And this is why I think it is very important that we are sent abroad as a representative of the state. And that's a very heavy responsibility for anyone, but especially I think it is very important for smaller countries. Diplomacy is important for every country, you know, big or small. But for smaller countries, because they have to navigate through a very big power competitions around the world, it is very, very important that you understand how you are going to promote, how you are going to position yourself at the global level, and what are your core interests that you promote. I think this is how we look at it, you know, when we talk about diplomacy. So when you know, I served in the diplomatic service for 30 years, and Nepal is one of the countries which has remained always independent throughout its history. And it is very important that you not only promote that you are a land of Himalayas and land of Buddha, but you have people here who have expectations, who have aspirations, who wish to join the family of international community as a very proud but also successful and a prosperous nation. And this is a very important responsibility and challenge and the expectation of the people in the international level. So this is what we do, and every country does that. And you have to understand that there is no world government as such where you go and you have a rule and you make sure that there is a coercive power, they will implement it. Unlike in the nation state, you have a rules, you have a coercive power of the state, and then it enforces it. But there are only three things that you should do. You have to have a very strong power of logic, that you have to convince others that why what you are saying is important for you and others. Two, you have to invoke moral principles. You know, why equity, justice at the international level is very important. And third, you have to find a way to really promote collective interest. Then that is of interest to them. And this is precisely what we try to do. And I think in the long period of service that I was in the diplomatic service, we try to promote our national interest overall, which is, of course, promoting your sovereignty and integrity is number one. But second most important thing is how to really promote your economic interest, your interests, so that you can also have a respectable life in the country, but also get a very strong support from the international community to go ahead. This is a very important perspective. And the third, which is very important for all of us, is that in what way we can also contribute to the international community. We are also part of the international level, and you have heard that we contribute to the international peacekeeping operations. This is a very important contribution from Nepal to the global community. But we also get support from the international community to what we want to do here. You know, we have many diplomatic missions here, and that is the engagement that we do. Now, at the international level, it is a very difficult. Of course, you have certain principles. You know, there is a sovereign equality among all nations. There is a pacific, you know, the peaceful settlement of disputes that we promote. There is a global cooperation that we try to promote. But if you look at the world, is it really like that? It is not. There is a lot of conflict going around the world. The poverty is very high. And then, of course, you know, the world is highly competitive. You have to really promote your interest in that very environment that we are in. Therefore, for smaller countries, I think this is what I want to tell you. How do you really promote the interest of, by the way, we are not a very small country as such. I said smaller, which is very important, smaller than others, but not necessarily very small. If you look at the countries, you know, at the international level, we are about 50th, you know, out of the 200 countries that we have, 193, we come, in terms of the population, we are 50th. But the challenge is that in terms of our GDP, we are almost 100th. And then if you look at our, you know, the per capita income, we are almost 170th. And that makes it very hard when you look at the global level. Therefore, when, you know, we were promoting our interest, we have to really say that we have always been independent. We try to contribute to the international community. We have a geostrategic position between China and India, but we have to have a good relationship with both India and China, but we have to go beyond that, because that is where we want to ensure that we are also part of the global family. I think this is one of the biggest challenges, that when we go around the world, you have to remember first that how to really get the interest of the international community to you. And that is the fundamental, you know, the question that we constantly ask. Therefore, I said in the beginning, the power of logic, and to make it relevant for others, you know. Of course, it is very important when you look at yourself. From here, we are very important, and we all of that. But then how do you really go around and tell them what we want to contribute and what they want to contribute has a lot of meaning and significance. That's why this importance of having a collective interest, promoting collective interest in the international community is very important. I tell you, in a very globalized world like this, if there is a lack of peace, there is a conflict around one country in the world, naturally it affects many countries around the world. You have a disease, and then you can fly from one place to the other, we heard, and we are so much connected. If there is no peace in one country, then the drug problem will probably increase, arms trafficking will increase, human trafficking will increase. You have seen it many, you know, places in North Africa, and then you have refugees in Europe. So, since we are in a very integrated world, everybody's interest is the interest of everyone's. So if having peace and prosperity in this country is also of interest to the international community. And the second question, of course, is a question of morality. I think this is what we promote very, very strongly. You know, in this day and age, when we have so much capacity, look at the technology, look at the economic advancement of so many countries, we still are burdened with poverty of a very high degree in many countries around the world, including countries like Nepal. So, yes, there has been a reduction of poverty in the last 20 years, 25 years. You look at the global picture, you know, we have gone down to almost 8% of the global population as now below poverty level. But look at the countries, the vulnerable countries, even countries like Nepal, we have still now 16 to 70% of the people who are below the global poverty line. Look at the countries around the world in Africa, especially the least developed countries, they have 33% of the population below poverty line today. So this average really masks the difference. So you have to really look at, you know, what are the areas where we really need collaboration and cooperation. And if you reduce and eradicate poverty, everybody will be helping everyone. So these are the issues that we fought very hard, in what way the international community can help them grow better, help them advance their economy so that they can deal with the poverty. The countries like Nepal are not only asking for money or the, you know, but they are asking the capacity to take care of ourselves. And that is the message that we try to really get in the international community. And that was something which was very important. And when I joined the United Nations as a senior, you know, the political advisor to the Ban Ki-moon, looking after the interest of the least developed, landlocked, and the small island developing state, the constant challenge that we had is that, is the international community really focused on eradicating poverty from these countries with the necessary support? As I said, the foreign assistance is only one part of it. In fact, it's not a very big part. What we looked at when I was there is that, yes, we have to look at the foreign assistance. That is important because there is a commitment of the international community. And they are latecomers. There are poor people. But then again, they have expectation. They are aspiration. They can be so much contributive to the international community. The second point that we focused on was on trade issue. If these countries are given more opportunity to have a better trade deal with the international community, perhaps they will grow better. And then we also looked at investment, how you can promote investment going into these countries. And then, of course, technology plays a very important role. How we can really promote technology going into these countries. They have to leapfrog from the current level of economic growth. You cannot leapfrog because the other countries have a very good advantage because, you know, they started early. You have always an advantage of an early mover. You are there because you took advantage of the situation. You are quite ahead, and naturally, you cannot compete. You know, those who are latecomers have a hard time competing with the other unless you have a big market or you have a big resources. That's why this is a very big challenge that is there at the international level, I think. But we really created a kind of a, you know, the policies at the UN to make sure that if we lift all the boats, the world will be a better place and everybody will have opportunity to really grow and of course, prosper. And that would be in the interest of every country. The third point was about the collective interest that I was saying. You know, it is not only a moral issue. And of course, I mean, everybody would like to love to help others so that everybody can grow, which is a very important thing. But as I said earlier, it is also in the interest of the developed countries to make sure that every country goes, because you get a good market. You can sell your products over there. And you can also get, you know, the good people, well-trained and educated people, which can also come and help you. And then perhaps, you know, there will be a circular migration. People will come and go. And so this type of international exposure will also give a very good advantage to the countries which are already developed. And thirdly, of course, if you look at the challenges around the world, as I said earlier, because of the integrated and a very globalized world, any problem that you have in one place of the world now is a global problem. Now, no country, how resourceful and how powerful they are, they cannot live like a self-contained island these days. No, this is 21st century. You can reach from one corner of the world to the other in 24 hours, basically. So that's the nature of integration that we are in. That's why it is in the self-interest of the developed countries itself to make sure that everybody grows. Just like, you know, you live in a neighborhood. If everybody grows, then you also don't feel threatened as well. It's just as like that at the global level as well. If you have poverty, if you have this sort of the vulnerable population and challenges, and to take them together is also, therefore, is in the interest of the international community. So those are some of the things that we tried to promote when I was there. And I think there is a very strong international movement now going on. You might have heard about the Sustainable Development Goals, which is a very important goal. For the first time, international community has a global development framework, which is, by the way, not only looking at human development, which is very important, but also economic growth, industrialization, infrastructure, but equally important, environmental sustainability. That is another very important issue for all of us, but especially for countries like Nepal. Two major agreements. One is on the Sustainable Development Goals, and another is on the climate change. You all know that we are one of the countries which are, you know, dependent on natural resources so much. So because we have our dependence on natural resources is so high, we also get a very strong, you know, the impact of any dislocation and change in that. So what does that mean? You know, we have the Himalayas. If you look at the water coming from the Himalayas, and that is the major, you know, the water system for the whole of South Asia, you know, is coming from the Himalayas and the Hindu Kush Mountains in this region. We have about 220 million people in this region, you know, if you look at the whole of 8 countries in the Himalayan region. But, you know, mind you, 1.6 billion people depend on the water coming from the Himalayas. And part of that is also in Nepal. So when you look at the climate change issue, we are also contributory to the global level. You know, the water that is coming from the Himalayas goes to India and then also, you know, gives irrigation and other facilities to many of these people living there. They can drink water, they can have the irrigation facilities, and they can also have hydro, and we can also do the hydroelectric projects. But this climate change is having a very far-reaching negative impact on the mountain system as a whole now. Look at the glaciers, they are melting. Look at the water, you know, the capacity or carrying capacity of the mountains, which is being reduced. So there is also a very important issue for all of us. There has been an agreement. You might be knowing that there is a Paris Agreement on climate change, but we are really worried that not all countries are equally committed to bring down the climate change, you know, the impact that is happening, and especially the rising temperature. So that is also another very important issue. I think we can give an example to others that how, by protecting our natural resources, we can also ensure better future for our people and for the next generation around the world, and how we can also be contributory to the life, livelihood, and the prosperity of other people. So this way, if you look at the global level, we can contribute a lot, but also we expect contributions in terms of promoting our interest in the international community. I think that is very important for us. As I said, there is no World Cup as such, but we have very important principles which are enshrined in the United Nations Charter. And for smaller countries, and smaller again, I would say, those with limited capacity, it is a very important institution because, as I said, it promotes sovereign equality. You are equal among all the countries, no matter who are big or small in terms of your, the principles. And then you also promote peaceful settlement of disputes. If there is a problem, you have a discussion and you resolve it. And the third, of course, you promote international cooperation, solidarity through the principles of international relations. I think those are some of the very important issues which are very, very, which will have a far-reaching impact for countries like Nepal. When I was there, I saw conflicts are happening around the world, and we should see that part of the region we have these types of conflict is, of course, there is one is ideological. You'll always have some ideology, either it is religious or some ideology. But the other part is because of poverty, it is also because of deprivation. So if you reduce deprivation, if you reduce marginalization, if you reduce poverty, it will again contribute to the international peace and prosperity. And that's why we believe that the multilateral diplomacy is very important, bilateral relations important. Diplomacy plays a very important for all countries, but especially for those countries who want to promote their interest and who want to also see that their contribution is recognized by the international community as a contributor to international peace, prosperity, and the overall development of each and every country. I think that is very important for us. And this is what I have learned, this is what I have also contributed at the global level. And I'm sure that as an the citizen of an independent and a very proud nation and a very dynamic people that we have seen, this is one of the major resources that we have. We will be really further promoting our interest and, of course, enhancing our aspirations and fulfilling our aspirations and expectations in the days. Thank you very much.